the background of it. I mean, really, really serious, okay? I'm not talking about that. There are a lot of things that will cause tears, but not a perfect display of emotion, not tears of joy over good things, but we're talking about life-making situations. That's the idea of having this. Biblical grief is seen in many passages of Scripture. Grief would be spiritually advantageous for a more comprehensive review that I will give you this morning. If you're in a season of grief right now, visit in touch. But if not, you're probably going to be at some point that visit you. Biblical grief is seen in Psalm 61, reading to you verses 1 and 2. David said, "Hear my cry, O God. Attend unto my prayer. From the end of the earth will I cry unto thee. My prayer is overwhelming. He said, lead me to the rock that is higher than I." Psalm 42, verse number 3, the psalm is there. Psalm 42, verse number 3, what my tears have defiled the sinners. Don't forget the biblical grief is coming in the morning of the families. The man of the world is quiet with grief. And because grief is seen in the Lord Jesus, I will refer to Isaiah 53, verse number 3. He is to be the man of sorrows and pain and retreat. Because grief is seen in the humanity of the Father, we understand that he is our sin. John 11:35, where Jesus weeps and prays to him. It's Luke 19:51, where Jesus wept over the city that loved. It's Hebrews 5:7-9, where you read that Jesus weeps. He was grieved that he anticipates the cross. All of it. And what I would like us to do this morning, by way of an outline, is I would like us to consider several ways that I pray this morning. We will consider the variety of grief, the variety of grief. Secondly, we'll consider the brevity of grief. And we'll close down to that this morning. Now, I'd like to show you the idea of the complexity of grief that protects this place. Fourthly, the purity of grief and the integrity of the power. So, variety, brevity, complexity, purity, and recovery. So, considering, first of all, the variety of grief. And variety gives the idea of variety in type. But the variety in type will bring about a variety in scale. So, you know, you can try to go around the room and ask people to resemble seasons of grief in their lives, and there will be a variety of different seasons of grief. Your story will vary, right? With different circumstances, different aspects, some common denominators, some severity types, and then varying levels of severity. I summarize these various types in these three ways. Bereavement, very common type of grief, talking about the loss of a loved one. You're bereaved. The loyalty that had been previously proclaimed was completely different. The vows, the word of silence, and some of the crowds. Thank you. that might come in mind, but to be constructed by the Lord's Spirit. The fall that we have given at this table, which is coffee table, and then what we make, and how to think about it, the walk of heaven.
Part of your entire life
what's greater is if you're a Christian, you possess eternal life. And Jesus is not a part of the kingdom of wisdom. But the God of the New Jerusalem, John the Revelator, said in Revelation 21, verse number 4, that God shall wipe away all tears from us. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow, nor crying, neither shall there be any more blood for the fallen things are passed away. It's rather the temporary condition. Christ has a variety, a brevity, and a chosen of glory and necessity. Necessity. No traveling but for a fixed and first Peter. Little phrase of the sentence is if Christ is necessity, if we do choose. Unfortunately, as we suggest, technical wisdom claims that it is an unfortunate thing that grief is the reality that much of the world will end. Grief is a necessity in and with life only because of our physical world. Grief often occurs as we come to the metaphorical forms and symbols of the physical truth. Groaning, by the way, is described in Romans 8. Groaning is a sound of a grieving person making noise as if it's prevailing in pain because it's there. All of creation is groaning as it's prevailing in pain. The grief is necessary because of the reality of our physical world. Grief is real. Your grief, your pain, your sorrow is real. It is from a situation of our general idea through grief. It's a reality. And only the reality is the world is full of grief. Except the whole grief is growing. But not only is grief necessary because of the situation in which we live, but also grief is necessary to conform us to Christ's likeness. I mean, after all, he was acquainted with grief, and therefore his followers will be acquainted. Grief is necessary to conform us to Christ's likeness, but also grief is necessary to foster our spiritual growth. Grief will then distinguish our propensity towards Jesus' comfort. Faith will hopefully entail the recognition of our deep and from God. It is necessary to foster spiritual growth. Again, we have this propensity towards independence. God, I've got some resources, I've got some intellect, I've got some financial means. God is fine. The reminder that though we have the most secure that already is God, ignites the recognition of our dependence on Him. This is a reminder of the the purity of grief, I want to focus in on this idea of grief. Tribe with fire. And notice that the verse continues. Tribe with fire might be found, and it might be found, and your faith might be found unto that faith and honor and glory of the accused of Jesus Christ. So you say, I went through bereavement. I went through depression. I experienced serious burden. Here's the purity of the Christian faith over the world. I recognize God's goodness to me. All of it was painful, all of it was grief, all of it brought sorrow and pain to my life. But as I was strong, I found that all of that brought praise and honor and glory to the Lord Jesus Christ. That was the purity of grief. The Apostle Paul often articulated the grief that he experienced, yet the glory he was able to give God through it. Because we have the same spiritual resources at our disposal as the Apostle Paul. But he is here in front of us, grief. You know, when your situation, the trial, and the confinement that you face, that which has caused you grief, is tried with fire, when you're tried with fire. I was the one burdened by it. And then self-absorbed, it's self, self, self. I was tried with fire, and it was found through bruises, betrayal, and burden, I became bigger. Thank you. grief is not the same as their grief, because they're dealing with their first pain. And sometimes that's what you need to do, because you are ready. And so there's this sense of community. These are the ones who have been called out of darkness into this marvelous light. I think the phrase is Peter, right? And it's just that, you know, the church, you know, as part of the recovery from grief is to just get around people who understand a biblical explanation of grief. I mean, we can weep with you when it's appropriate to weep, but then discern you and encourage you from the beginning to encourage you. They can experience things that are drawn from the church. Jesus. I want you to remember that we saw the difference of the Lord's life. You understand that? I talked to the first person in chapter 4, verse number 13, that the temptation made that between the way a Christian believer in Christ saw it and the way the world saw it. I like how verse number 13 starts out with the idea that we're not called to be ignorant. In other words, you need to understand the distinction between breathing like the world and the word Christian. Don't be ignorant. Have a level of understanding. In other words, you frame up your mind in the context of how you saw it. What Paul is doing as he writes to those Thessalonian believers is he's telling them that their mind should inform their emotions. He's explaining to them that your theology should inform your truth. He's explaining that what you know about the Bible should impact your belief. What you know about the Bible, what you know about the truth, what you know about the important, what you know about the resurrection from the dead. What you know about God impacts the way that you think. The reason you want to be you want to have an informed mind so that you can't end up a very thoughtful person and thought that it would be. A strong mind rooted and grounded in biblical truth that is such an impossible. God can use your situation of grief to open